These are three mini projects that I've made, and they all have one thing in common, the AT Tiny. Now, I've made three of them because I'm going to use them as Christmas gifts, but that isn't the point of this video. Instead, we're going to focus on the AT Tiny itself, and some more advanced AVR programming topics, such as sleep mode and accessing the flash memory. And as an added bonus, you'll learn how to make the projects themselves. So, without further ado, let's dive in. This video will also assume that you have at least some basic knowledge of AVR and Atmega programming. For this video, we will focus on the AT Tiny 85 specifically. So let's set up the bare minimum circuit. It's literally just VCC, ground, and a 10K pull-up on reset. You can also optionally place a crystal in the X-Tile pins if you need one, but for what we are doing, it's not necessary. You can also add your programmer's pins as needed. Beyond this point, everything that we will add is application specific and is not required. Here's an interesting piece of history. This was one of my first electronics projects. I made this for an engineering class about 5 years ago. And as you can see, 15-year-old me wasn't nearly as competent at soldering or circuit design as I am now. So what we will do today is refurbish the circuit inside. What I'd like to do is to give the LEDs a breathing pattern, sort of like what I did back in the PIC video. To make this work, we have two options. We could either use software to run our PWM signal, or we could use one of the timer peripherals to generate an appropriate PWM signal. For this project, I went with the timer-based PWM method since it will make our main loop cleaner and easier to read. For this purpose, I went with timer 0. This timer has several modes of operation, but we will stick with the fast PWM mode. Basically, in fast PWM mode, the timer counts up like normal. But when the timer's value is equal to the value in the output compare register, then the output pin is pulled low. Once the timer resets, the output pin is pulled high again. Let's set up the hardware for this. The PWM output will be placed on OC0B, which is the same as PB1. So, what I did was I placed a resistor onto the base of an NPN transistor. This transistor will now act as our switch for all of the LEDs that we will add. Let's get into the code that I have written to get the timer's PWM up and running. The very first line is modifying the TCCR0A register. Here, we have to modify the WGM bits. If you take a look at the table in the datasheet, you'll find a list of modes based on these three bits. And as you can see, I selected the last option, which is our fast PWM mode. Now, to get our PWM signal out onto the pin, we need to do two things. First, set the COM0B1 bit in the TCCR0A register. This will enable a non-inverting PWM output on the OC0B pin. Next, we need to set the PWM pin as an output, which corresponds to PB1 on DDRB. Now we can finally test everything by enabling the clock without a prescaler and using the TCCR0B register. As you can see, we have a 50% duty cycle on our output, and we can change it by modifying the OCR0B register. But we want that breathing effect, and to do that we can enable the timer 0 overflow interrupt. Now we can change the PWM duty cycle in the interrupt. I've created a struct to hold information about the current PWM settings. The duty cycle and direction variables should be a little bit obvious. They simply keep track of the current duty cycle and which direction it should go next. The postscale variable is there for me to provide a software postscaler. Basically, I want the interrupt to activate once every 256 timer overflows. I also added a helper function that simply converts a duty cycle that is between 0 and 100 to the corresponding percentage of 255 for the timer. Beyond that, the interrupt simply counts either up or down depending on the direction. However, as you can see, the linear approach doesn't look the greatest, because it looks like the LED is on most of the time. To fix this, I made a scaling function. Basically, at the lower duty cycles, the change either up or down is very small, but at the higher duty cycles, the change is much larger. This essentially balances out the bright and dim periods of the LED. And as you can see, our LED is now breathing properly. Now, for the actual physical construction. Since this is a project that I made so long ago, I no longer have access to the original tools that I used to make the thing. So, unfortunately, I cannot demonstrate it on camera. The biggest thing that you have to know about this, though, is that the acrylic at the top here was carved using a laser engraver. And the box was also cut using a laser engraver as well. But let's take a moment from the box and get to the soldering. I simply wired three LEDs up in parallel and then placed them all in series with the collector of the transistor. I also added a button to toggle the whole thing on and off, but I'll talk more about this button in the next project. And finally, I added a USB port to supply our 5 volts power to the circuit. And to complete the project, we simply just have to drill some big holes for the new USB port and the button. And as you can see, the finished product looks really cool, especially when you turn out the lights. This next project was made for my brother, who is obsessed with Bitcoin. When we press the button, the LEDs breathe, and it looks very similar to the Vader project, but it has one key difference. It is battery powered. That's why the LEDs turn off after a while, since we want to save power. But it goes much deeper than just turning off the LEDs, and this is where I have to explain sleep mode to you. In sleep mode, we basically turn off parts of the microcontroller. In our case, we turn off most everything to save as much power as possible. In the datasheet, you will find three different sleep modes. Idle mode, ADC noise reduction mode, and power down mode. We are most interested in power down mode since it essentially turns off 99% of the microcontroller. The only things still active are the baud, if enabled, the watchdog timer, if enabled, and the pin change interrupts. At this point, there are very few things that can still wake the CPU back up. But one of those few things is a pin change interrupt. So, to enable this pin change interrupt, I simply added a button to ground along with a pull-up resistor on PB2. I then enabled pin change interrupts in the GIMSK register, and specified PB2 in the PCMSK register. Now, we will leave the actual interrupt service routine empty since we are not interested in executing code here. We are only interested in the wake-up functionality. Now, let's get to work on our microcontroller getting to sleep. Luckily, AVR GCC comes with some handy helper methods for this. Make sure to include the avrsleep.h header. The bare minimum for sleep functionality goes as follows. First, set your sleep mode. We are using the power down mode for this project. Next, set sleep enable. This method doesn't actually put your microcontroller to sleep, but it allows the next call, sleep CPU, to put the microcontroller to sleep. Now, we stop here until our interrupt wakes up the microcontroller. Then, the next line that it executes is sleep disable. This is good and all, but we need to flesh it out a little bit more. We just need to disconnect the PWM line from OC0B so that we don't accidentally leave the LEDs on while the microcontroller is sleeping. Then, we can re-enable it after waking up from sleep. Let's test the current draws during active mode and sleep mode. To make the test more fair, I removed the LED. In active mode, I measured an average current of about 1 milliamp. In sleep mode, I at first measured a current of 86 microamps, which seemed a bit high. Then I remembered to remove the programmer from the circuit. After doing this, I measured a new current of just 0.2 microamps. So it's definitely very important to keep the microcontroller in sleep mode when not in use for the sake of extending battery life. In the main loop of our code, I simply have it delaying for 10 seconds, then immediately going back into sleep mode. We can now finally start talking about how I made the PCB. The schematic is basically the same as the first project, except this time we have a lot more LEDs. The components are also obviously surface mount as well, in the 0806 size. There is also a coin cell battery holder on the back. The biggest part difference is the microcontroller itself. This time, I use an AT2025 instead of the AT2085 that we were using. Don't worry though, these two chips are basically the exact same thing. The only difference between the two is that the 25 has a smaller flash size and RAM size than the 85. So, as long as your code doesn't use too much memory, it should compile and run exactly the same on both. Let's talk about how I got this Bitcoin logo onto the silkscreen. For whichever image you choose, you need it to have two main colors, otherwise you will lose some quality. Luckily, Bitcoin only has white and orange, so it will work just fine for this purpose. Next, get an SVG of your image. You will take it into an image editing program. I personally use GIMP for this purpose. From here, just open the SVG and then export it as a BMP file. Next, go to KiCad and select Image Converter. Load your BMP file and adjust the black and white threshold until you get a clear image. You may need to check the negative box to reverse the black and white colors. Also, adjust the size as needed. Next, select the footprint option, then export to file. Afterwards, click on Footprint Editor. From here, make a new library and name it whatever you wish. Import the file that you just created and make any extra edits as needed. I simply unchecked the fill shape box to make the whole thing hollow. After you save, you can go to your PCB file and press A. Search for your new image and place it wherever you wish. After this, you can design your PCB as normal. As for the assembly of this project, I got the stencil along with the PCB, and I used it to spread the solder paste. Afterwards, I placed all the components and used the hot plate to solder everything. I had to hand solder the programming header and the battery holder on the back. I also made a mistake on the schematic at first. I had the button connected to VCC. So, to fix the problem, I took a knife and cut the trace. I then used some very tiny wire to connect the button to ground. And with this fix, here's the final project. I have to say that it makes for a really good gift. And to not leave anyone hanging from the first project, I'll briefly explain that button. It's there simply to toggle the sleep mode. The button interrupts during sleep mode, and then pulls to go to sleep. This last project that we'll complete is very reminiscent of my very first video, but it's certainly an improvement. Luckily, it's not all that much different from the first two projects. The main difference this time is that we will need to vary the frequency of the waveform instead of the duty cycle. To make this work, we will have to stop using timer 0 and switch over to timer 1. Timer 1 has an additional register, OCR1C, that allows us to change the top value of the timer. This means that if we set a lower top value, we will get a faster frequency. As for the schematic for this project, it's quite literally the same as the first two, but with the addition of two more LEDs on PP0. But we will talk about those LEDs in a minute. It's a nice coincidence that OC1A is on the same pin as OC0B. Anyways, we need to determine what prescaler we should use to get our desired frequency. You can run a simple calculation to determine your minimum frequency. Simply divide your system clock, which is 1 MHz by default, by 256, and your prescaler value. If we don't use a prescaler, we get a frequency of 4 kHz, but that's a bit too high. Instead, we can use a 64 times prescaler and get a minimum frequency of 61 Hz, which is much more suitable for music. Speaking of calculating frequencies, we can make a helper function that will select the right OCR1C value for our desired frequency. Simply divide the system clock by the prescaler and the desired frequencies. Make sure to also set the OCR1A register because it controls our duty cycle. I always made it 50%. We can now select arbitrary frequencies to output. Now to play music, we can select certain frequencies that correspond with musical notes. There's this helpful web page that you can use which shows you the connections between notes and frequencies. I simply copied them over into a header file to make it easier to type in our code. You can download this header in the description to save yourself the time of copying it yourself. Let's try to make a song. I made a note structure to help us with this process. First, we have the frequency as we expect, but afterwards we have the length. In sheet music, there are different notes which correspond to different lengths. We have eighth notes, quarter notes, half notes, and full notes. So I define each one as 1, 2, 4, and 8 respectively. A note can also have a dot, which means that you hold it for another half length. I define dot as the last bit. This allows us to bitwise or it into our length. Let me show you a practical example of a song in action. A song is simply a collection of notes, so we can make an array of our notes. Let's make Jingle Bells for an example. Our first note is D right above middle C, so we will type D4. We can see that it is a quarter note, so we type that in. The next note is a B4 quarter note. This process continues until we reach this note. This is a dotted half note, so we type in D4, then half. Then we OR in the dot to represent our dot. Hopefully this process is simple enough for you to follow yourself. Let's now make a helper function to play these notes. The first thing to do is to make sure that the frequency isn't zero. If it is, don't play anything. To help with this, I made the disable PWM output and enable PWM output functions to help with these problems. Afterwards, we set our frequency to the note frequency. The last thing to do is to determine how long we should hold this note for. The beat length variable is the length of a quarter note in milliseconds. So, to dynamically determine the length of time, we can use this relationship to determine the length of the other notes. The first half of the equation simply divides beat length by 2 to get the length of an eighth note, then multiplies by the type of note. We AND out the dot bit for this purpose. The second half is a bit more interesting. We add half of the original length if there is a dot. And I can honestly say that this is the first time that a double not has ever been useful in my code. Basically, the purpose of the double not is to move our eighth bit down to a 1, if it exists. That way, we either multiply by a 1 or a 0. The not operator will return either a 1 or a 0 depending on whether or not the value is non-zero. The problem is that it is inverted, so we just invert it again. Hence the double not. After this point, the song actually plays pretty well. So let's go ahead and add another song. And wait a minute. Why does the song glitch? The only change to the code at this point was adding another song to memory. Well, let's take a second to appreciate just how small the ATtiny's RAM space actually is. The ATtiny 85 only has 256 bytes of RAM, and our new song is taking up too much space. But we still have so much flash available, so what gives? Well, the AVR architecture has flash on a different address space than the RAM, so the C compiler doesn't automatically just use everything in flash. Luckily, we can manually save our data into flash with progmem. This ensures that the song will stay in flash and keep our RAM clean. But, like I said, the flash is on a different address space, so we just can't access it in the same way as normal. Instead, we have to use this method, memcopyp. This will allow us to copy our note in flash to our temporary note in RAM. After this change, we can play both songs glitch-free. I also added another struct to make everything a bit more organized, and it allows us to change our beat length on a song-by-song basis. To wrap the code up, I made two more songs and added a for loop to allow us to rotate through all of the songs. And for the assembly, it's basically the same as the Bitcoin. I spread solder paste over the stencil, and then used a hot plate to melt the solder. And to answer that question, the extra LEDs are there to blink with every note played. And I think it makes for a really cool effect. Well, that's just about covered. Whether or not you were interested in the Christmas aspect of these projects, hopefully you've learned something new about microcontroller programming. If you did, please consider subscribing so that you can see my future videos. Also, visit my Buy Me a Coffee page. With your support, I can keep making videos like this one. I'd like to thank Mr. Dev Null and Cognizant for being channel members. Anyways, thanks for watching. Have a good one.